September 16th, Billings, Montana. The word had come through the office pretty fast that another victim had been found. Same MO as the previous three. Jared and Xander had immediately dropped their research and followed the rush of agents out of the office. At the scene, Xander was struck by how many people had shown up. He counted police, FBI, paramedics, reporters, civilian looky-loos, and God alone knows how many other people. Xander shook his head and followed Jared into the scene. Christ. Why doesn't anyone ever show up before the damn massacre? Xander followed Jared as he led his way through the crime scene. The area had been sanitized by the forensic experts a few minutes earlier, but the sight and smell caused even Xander's experienced stomach to turn. The perp arranges the organs of his victims in a way that satisfies his image of what his private demon expects, Jared said, playing his flashlight over the body, examining the symbols inscribed in blood around the carefully placed corpse. The incisions are precise, but not surgical. Probably indicative of a ceremonial dagger as opposed to a scalpel? Xander shook his head. He couldn't fathom how Jared kept his head given the situation. Xander was able to force down the bile sufficiently to operate while he was exposed to horrors. Like this, but Jared had totally pushed it aside. He could see the emotion present in the man's eyes. But that was the only place it showed through. Xander stood back and watched as Jared moved through the scene as though he'd done it 1,000 times before. September 23rd, Billings, Montana. So we have it down to 3 suspects? Jared looked over the files carefully. Xander shifted his head from where it had fallen on the desk and muttered quietly, "Jeez, man, are you human? How do you shift through that stuff so easily?" Jared shrugged. I had a very focused childhood. Man, that's not natural. It's who I am, Jared said simply as he spread the files out on the desk. How much time did your friend G-Man say there was going to be between the rituals? Inwardly, Xander snickered. Giles was going to kill him if he ever met Jared. 13 days? So that leaves us less than 24 hours to narrow down the suspects. Xander forced himself back up and shook his head to clear it. Okay, research boy rides again. Let's look at these guys one more time. Janice Tesh. She rode the dot-com rocket last year and bailed just before the crash. Reinvested her money into steady industries. Gold, oil, and blue chip companies. Slightly odd that someone who made their money by risking everything would suddenly become so conservative in their portfolio. Xander looked at the file. Janice was fairly attractive, blonde, late 30s, with no listed family. She had no obvious links to any occult group or anything even remotely hellmouthy. Next. Raymond Salino. Played the market last year. Took a lot of big risks and that paid off. He's currently under investigation for insider trading. Xander shook his head. No, G-Man was pretty specific. If this was our guy, he'd be clean. The investigation would have been shut down before it even got started. Jared nodded. He wasn't certain about that. But the man didn't fit the profile in other ways. He was a Christian who never missed Sunday Mass. He had 2 kids and a wife, and according to a psych report Jared had hacked from the man's therapist, he had an almost pathological fear of blood. That leaves Dennis Pierce. He was discovered last year, and has made a small fortune playing the part of Rick Rocker Richards on a series that's being filmed on location here. It's probably just paranoia, but the fact that he's involved in show business kind of spooks me. LA's pretty close to my hometown, and I can tell you that we get more than our fair share of the weird stuff around home. Jared looked over the file closer. He was away on location when the second sacrifice was found, but the time of death places the murders several hours before his plane left. So he's still possible then? Jared nodded. Yes. The third sacrifice was 13 days after the first. That's confirmed by both your Mr. G-Man and the coroner's time of death report. He was back in town 2 nights earlier. Xander pushed himself off the desk. Let's check him out. Las Vegas, Nevada. Miss Parker scowled as she watched the sweepers rummage through the room, looking through the latest nest that Jared had left behind. Miss Parker, take a look at this. She jammed a stick of nicotine gum into her mouth as she strode across the darkened room that the sweeper had called from. What? She snarled. The sweeper wordlessly flicked on the light. Miss Parker's jaw dropped as she stared at the room. the half-chewed stick of gum falling to the ground. "What in the hell?" she whispered as she stared around the black and red painted room. On the floor was a pentagram, painted in blood red, and the walls were covered in arcane symbols. An ornate dagger was resting in a bowl of what appeared to be blood, alongside a cutting board that was plastered with some of the most disgusting things she'd had the misfortune to see. Without a word, she stepped over the table, dipped her finger in the bowl. Lifting it to her face, she sniffed it for a moment before popping her fingers into her mouth and licking it clean. Around her, the hardened sweepers suddenly paled and looked like they were about to be sick. She turned around, a disgusted look on her face. "It's movie blood, you idiots. Corn syrup and food coloring. Get back to work." She walked across to where Sydney was studying several texts on Satanism and occult worship. "What is Rat Boy sticking his nose into now, Sid?" Sydney shrugged. "I do not know, but it would appear that he has simulated a cult environment complete with ritual sacrifice." "Tell me something I can't see with my own eyes, Sydney." Outside, she could hear the sound of brutes retching. Dennis Pierce was living the American adolescent dream. He was constantly surrounded by movie stars and starlets and was paid to pretend to be someone exciting. When Jared and Xander caught up to him, he was wrapping up a shoot. "That's a wrap. Good job, everyone. Head home and be back by 6 a.m., people." Xander and Jared hung back, watching as a subject as he headed for his trailer. "What do you think?" Xander asked as he watched the man. "It's too early to tell." Jared shook his head and moved to follow the man. Xander nodded once and followed after the FBI agent. "Elan, can you pick up any demonic vibes off this guy?" "Get me closer, Alexander. The demonic energy from this type of ritual would be very slight." "All right." Xander caught up with Jared and laid a hand on his shoulder. "I have an idea. Let me go ahead." "If you're sure." Jared looked curious but held his questions. "I am." Xander grinned up at the man as he walked past and into the actor's trailer. When Dennis Pierce stepped out of the trailer, he was surprised to find a young man waiting for him. "Mr. Pierce, I'm a big fan and I was hoping to get an autograph." Dennis smiled. "Certainly, young man. Do you watch the show often?" "All the time, Mr. Pierce. I never miss an episode." "Really?" Dennis loved to hear that. "Well, who should I make the autograph out to?" "Alex Harris?" Dennis scribbled down a dedication and was about to hand it back to the young man when he noticed the boy twirling a silver baton in his hand. "What's that?" he asked curiously. Alex smiled. "This is Elan. I guess you could call her my old friend. Kept me safe in some rough neighborhoods." "A self-defense baton?" Dennis had considered getting one himself. "Mind if I have a look?" "Certainly." The boy grinned wider as he handed over the footlong silver club. Dennis toyed with the baton for a moment before shaking his head and handing it back. "No, I think I'm going to go with one of the telescoping models. More versatile, don't you think?" The boy chuckled. "Yeah, and less annoying too, I'd warrant." Dennis frowned in confusion as the boy turned and left. What the hell was that supposed to mean? "What the hell was that supposed to mean?" Elan demanded as they walked back away from the actor. "What?" Xander muttered under his breath. "You know damn well what. What did you mean by that annoying crack?" Xander grinned wide. "Exactly what I said. Now, was it him?" "Oh, I'm gonna make you regret that." "Let me guess. You're gonna annoy me some more?" "Yes. No. I mean, oh, you brazen..." Elan fumed. "Was it him?" Xander pressed. "Hmm? Oh, no. He's clean. No demonic energy at all. He isn't the subject of the spell." "Damn." "What is it?" Jared asked as Xander walked back, looking frustrated. "He's not our man." "Can you be sure of that?" Xander sighed. "I just am. Trust me on this, Jared. I know." Jared wasn't certain what to say or think. He could feel that Xander was sure of what he was saying. But could he trust the boy's confidence? People's lives were at stake. "What do you suggest?" Xander thought back. "The woman. Let's scope her out." Cheyenne Mountain, SGC. "He wasn't there?" "No, sir, General Hammond." Hammond ignored the slightly sarcastic tone in Colonel O'Neill's voice. "Then where was he?" "We don't know, sir," Daniel sighed as he took his place at the long table. "Frankly, sir, considering some of the things we found out in that town, I wouldn't be surprised if we never went back." O'Neill played with a pen as he spoke, his face perplexed. Why? From what we could tell, the kid blew up his school, or at least helped blow it up.
What?
Hammond blew up. And we have this nutcase running around with advanced alien technology and weapons? Not that simple, General, Carter spoke up. By all accounts, he did it to save the lives of everyone present at the graduation ceremony. We got a hold of some police records. Hacked some police records, Jack interrupted her. Yes, sir, I hacked into the police database. Carter blushed slightly. They wouldn't give us access, sir. Go on, Hammond prompted. According to the police file, as well as some files that were secured in a triple encrypted directory labeled Mayor, Harris has been a local vigilante of some skill for 3 years. He's disrupted gang activity and saved the lives of dozens of citizens, including several police officers and fire officials.
If he's a vigilante, then why hasn't he been arrested?
Carter shook her head. I have no idea, sir. The only notation we could find on him was that the mayor had handed down orders to leave him and his friends be.
The mayor is protecting vigilantes? Who the hell does he think he is, Commissioner Gordon?
Was, General.
Was.
Huh?
He vanished on graduation day.
No one's seen him in over 3 months. He's presumed dead, killed by gang members on PCP. Jack jumped in.
And that's another thing. For a crime with no witnesses and no evidence, that police report was terribly specific. Gang members on PCP. It says that same line over and over again, as if it's code for something.
For what, Colonel?
I don't know, General, Jack conceded. But I'll tell you this, that town gives me the creeps.
Janet Tess lived in a very nice neighborhood, surrounded by a very nice wall. Xander looked at the security floating around the home and swallowed. This isn't going to be easy.
Leave it to me, Jared spoke with certainty.
Janice screamed in frustration. The power had gone out 20 minutes earlier, and she was losing money every minute she couldn't get on her computer. The power company had promised to have someone over as quickly as possible, but they had the nerve to tell her that it could be up to 3 hours. She was about to throw a book at the unresponsive computer screen when the doorbell rang. When she answered it, a man in coveralls lowered his dark sunglasses and smiled at her.
City Electric Service, did you call about a power outage?
Xander shook his head, lifting a toolkit, following Jared into the house.
How the hell did he get all this gear in this van so quickly?
Please, the breaker is down this way. Xander just followed Jared as Jared followed Janice down the hall.
Milan, can you get anything off her?
Not yet. I have to get very close. Physical contact would be best.
Great, Xander muttered under his breath.
How am I supposed to do that? She doesn't seem like the type to ask to check out what a repairman is working with.
Not my department.
Xander sighed and followed Jared into the basement.
The Center, Blue Cove, Delaware.
Talk to me, Brutes.
Well, Brutes stammered. I have 3 cult-related situations that have made national news. 2 of them haven't involved the authorities yet, so I wasn't able to get much. The third is a series of ritual murders in Billings, Montana. Oh, and get this, a new investigator just took over the case. Jared Ford.
That's it?
Have the jet ready for takeoff, Miss Parker snapped to the sweeper behind her.
Brutes looked nervous, but spoke up.
There is one off thing.
Jared Ford brought an assistant with him from the home office.
An assistant? Sydney looked curious.
Jared normally works alone.
I know.
Brutes looked even more nervous. Miss Parker narrowed her eyes.
We're checking it out anyways. What are the odds that an investigator named Jared shows up at a cult crime after that disgusting scene in Vegas?
Janice sighed in relief as the lights flickered back on and headed to the basement stairs to let the repairman know that the power was back. She reached the bottom of the stairs when a clank at her foot caused her to look down. One of the repairmen must have dropped this, she mused as she picked up the metal tube. She couldn't figure out what it was for, but she held it out when she got to the two men.
Did one of you drop this?
The young one grinned up at her from where he was rummaging in a toolbox.
Thanks, ma'am. I was just looking for that.
She handed it down to him and turned to the older repairman.
The power's back on upstairs. Are you almost done down here?
Yes, ma'am, he smiled again. Just finishing up. Jared led the way out of the house, feeling frustrated. His quick search of the house had yielded no connection to the murders or the occult in any way.
That was useless, he muttered to his companion, and was surprised to see a grim smile on Xander's face.
Oh, I wouldn't say that, Xander said simply. She's our man, so to speak.
How can you tell?
Inside info. Xander grinned and looked thoughtful. You know, if we're going to do this, I suppose I should try to fill you in on a few things.
What kind of things? Jared started the engine of the van and they pulled out of the driveway.
Xander took a breath.
Well, it's like this. 20 minutes later. Jared stared at the boy in the passenger seat for a long time, trying to decide if he was lying or insane. Normally, he would be able to decide something like that quickly, but Xander showed none of the signs of insanity, and he honestly seemed to believe the things he was saying.
Let me be sure I understand this, Jared began. Demons and vampires are real, and they run around the planet trying to end the world?
Some of them, Xander answered. Actually, I think that most of them probably try to avoid the end-of-day scenario as much as we do. The ones with any brains, at any rate.
Problem is that humans really weren't intended to be immortal, and the power kind of goes to their head.
From a theoretical viewpoint, Jared had to admit that he could see what Xander meant, but he shook it off, quickly.
Look, I don't mean to insult you or anything, but...
Xander grinned and finished for him. But I'm insane? Lying? Both?
Well, I was going to say confused, but yes, both sound about right.
Jared actually smiled back.
Xander laughed. I said the same thing, or close enough, the first time I heard about vampires.
I don't suppose you have any evidence.
Xander patted himself down with a puzzled expression on his face.
Evidence. Let's see, I have proof that aliens exist, but no, nothing on the supernatural, except Elan.
Elan? Jared asked slowly as they pulled the van into a parking spot.
Xander nodded and got out as Jared shifted into park. He waited for Jared to join him and drew the silver cylinder from the sheath that rode on his hip.
Jared, meet Elanthiel.
Jared raised his eyebrow in confusion.
Your defense baton.
Xander smiled and, after glancing around for spectators, activated the weapon.
My 10,000-year-old battle staff.
Jared started in shock when the foot-long baton became a 7-foot-long staff, gleaming in the setting sun. He stared for a long moment before speaking.
How did you do that?
I didn't. Elan did.
That's not possible, Jared said.
That much volume couldn't have been contained in such a small device.
Huh.
Xander looked at him for a second before his mind started to unravel what Jared said.
Oh, well, all I can say is, magic.
Xander deactivated the staff and tossed it lightly to Jared, who caught it neatly.
Elan has kept me alive through some very nasty situations. I owe her a lot.
You keep speaking like this weapon is a girl. Why is that?
She is, Xander shrugged. I don't pretend to understand it, but Elanthiel was a warrior at one point, whose soul was entrapped in the device of your holding. She's still in there, and will be for eternity, if what she's told me is true.
Jared looked at the small device, his eyes sad. Entrapped for eternity.
Yeah, I know, Xander said quietly. I have a hard time imagining it myself. Elan is how I know that Tesh is our woman. She's got a spidey sense for demonic energy.
Jared shook his head, passing the weapon back to Xander.
You're asking me to take a lot on faith.
I know, Xander said. But look at it this way. You don't risk anything by assuming that I'm right and taking some precautions.
Such as?
Xander grinned and grabbed his duffel bag from the back of the van.
Later that night,
Jared shook his head as he followed Miss Tesh into the caverns he had driven to. Tonight was possibly the last sacrifice she had to make to appease the demon she had forged a pact with, and he didn't know what he expected to see here. An insane woman who believed she could speak to demons, or a demonic entity who had been harvesting sacrifices from selfish men and women like Tesh for thousands of years. He knew that Xander was in the area, following him, both while nearly invisible in the odd armor he wore. Jared's mind was actually rushing to understand something for the first time in years. The existence of aliens, demons, magic, is almost too much, even for him to process.
I wonder if the center knows about any of it.
He smiled as he realized that the world had just gotten even larger than he had thought it to be. There was more out there to learn, more to study, and even more to do. He was feeling challenged for the first time in well over 2 decades, and Jared loved that feeling. He had sorely missed that feeling. Jared felt the weight of the small weapon Xander had passed to him, a Zat gun, and recalled the boy's instructions. 1 shot will stun a human, 2 will kill, and 3 is when you don't want the bodies to be found. A versatile weapon. I'll stay with 1 shot. Janice drew her robes over her shoulder as she went over the incantation in her mind. The victim, a young boy she had snagged from a playground earlier in the week, was tied solidly to the altar and anointed with bloods and oils for the sacrifice. The others had already arrived, taking their positions around the circle of power as she approached the altar. The time is here. She began the ceremony as she had the 12 other times. This was the last sacrifice she owned to Melkai, the 13th victim in exchange for her 13 weeks of success. She stepped over the bound child and raised the blade into the air. Melkai, come forward and accept this offering. The air over the altar shimmered and slowly coalesced into a familiar demonic form. I am here, woman. Grant me my boon. The demonic voice reverberated through the room, causing those present to shiver in fear and anticipation. As you ask, so shall it be. Janice lifted the blade slightly higher and prepared to drive it down when a shout startled her. FBI, freeze! She turned in shock and stared at the man pointing a pistol in her direction. The electrician? Kill him! She screamed at the assembled people. The cultists stared at each other, Janice and the FBI agent, but didn't make a move. Mistress, one began. He has a gun. Janice roared at him. I don't care! Kill him! The demon spoke, its voice quietly reverberating through the room again. I will handle that one. Be prepared to grant me my boon, and another in payment for this service. Jared stared at the big thing actually floating across the floor towards him. My God, they do exist. He fired reflexively, each shot hitting the demon straight on, but not even phasing the abomination that was drifting towards him. Jared watched helplessly as it got closer, and was surprised when a blast from the far wall caught on the shoulder and wheeled it about. He saw a blurred form detach itself from the wall and shimmered into existence, recognizing the armor that Xander had put on. Melkai, Xander shouted as he deactivated his shift suit. I would have a word with you. The demon turned and stared at him, unrecognizable emotions playing across his demonic face. Nyutja, he snarled. What is your business here? I am not prey for your kind. Xander smiled under his mask. Damn, Ruther and his people have one hell of a rep. I am not Yucha, demon, and your kind are my only prey. The demon roared and went after Xander. Xander thumbed the firing stud for the plasma caster again, catching the demon square in the chest as it advanced, eliciting another roar of pain from the demon. When it was almost on him, he dove to one side and rolled clear. Xander, draw me and show me to him. Act confident. Huh? Xander thought as he came out of the roll. Trust me. Xander mentally shrugged and slid Elan clear of her sheath, and shifted his stance to stand square onto the demon. He held Elan aloft, parallel to the ground, and activated the ancient weapon. Do you recognize this, demon? Melkai stared at the glistening staff as it glinted with light reflected from all over the room. It's not possible. We destroyed them all. Xander's voice was cold as he repeated what Elanthiel said. You above all should know that these weapons cannot be destroyed, not even by your kind, demon. You hid them, you banished them, you even corrupted them, but you never destroyed them. Xander lowered the staff into a combat stance and stared at the demon. Come on, demon. My weapon wants vengeance, and I always try to give my friends what they want. Melkai roared, his voice tinged with as much caution as anger now, and moved forward to engage the armored warrior in battle. While the cultists watched the demon and the warrior start their battle, Janice Tesh edged towards the exit. She didn't care who won.
She just wanted to get clear of Ground Zero. She had just reached the edge of the door when a cold voice interrupted her thoughts. Going somewhere? Then, a sudden blinding flash of blue light sparkled against her eyes, and a rush of pain racked her body. Janice never saw the source of the voice, but she knew who it was all the same. The electrician, was her last thought before the world went dark. Xander ducked to the side and spun the line into the demon's back as it passed. Damn, this guy is slow. Those black monsters were more challenged than this. Do not get cocky, Alexander. Melkai is no warrior, but he will not die as easily as those creatures you faced off-world. Xander nodded as he ducked another powerful swing by the demon and struck out with the lion at the demon's wrist. He heard a satisfying crack followed by the demon's scream of pain. Well, in that case, I'll have to take him down one piece at a time. Xander lashed out again, bouncing a lion off the demon's jaw, and moved to follow through when the demon struck out with a hard shot that impacted him on the armored mask Xander wore. The blow lifted him clear of the ground and threw him across the room, slamming him into the far wall with enough force to shatter the cement. Ouch! Xander shook his head clear and tagged the demon again with the laser designator. He opened up with a plasma caster from 25 feet and poured on the fiery power until the demon dropped to the ground. Xander stumbled forward, eyeing the bleeding demon uncertainly. How do I kill this one? Until you learn to wield me properly? Same as usual. Xander nodded and drew the Japanese short sword Ruther had gave him. Something to be said for the basics. Jared watched as the demon went down under fire from the armored figure that was Xander. He saw Xander stagger to his feet and approach the wounded creature, drawing a sword as he did. Internally, his emotions were raging. The boy was about to kill another being in cold blood. But a demon. A demon who had caused the ritual sacrifice of at least 11 people, and most likely hundreds of others. A demon who could not be held accountable by law. Jared turned away from the sight as the blade flashed down, wincing at the sickening noise that he heard. Later, Janice Tesh awakened to the dark. She frantically tried to move, but realized that she was tied down. She looked around, her eyes widening when she saw the gleam of a dagger above her. "Who are you? What do you want?" she screamed. "What do I want?" the voice asked coldly, mockingly. "I thought it would be nice to be rich. So I'm going to sacrifice you, like you did those innocent people." "No," she screamed. "You can't do this to me!" The voice began to heat up. "I'm sure that's what they thought. Awakening here, scared and alone. But you wanted to be rich, so you killed them till your own private demon would grant you a wish. Didn't you? Didn't you? Didn't you?"
"Yes," she screamed, her terror building. "I did it. Now let me go."
"No," the voice turned cold again. "Like I said, I want to be rich." The dagger flashed down at her and she screamed, first in terror, then in pain. Then it all went black. Xander watched in awe as Jared played the woman's fears to the hilt. "Man, Jared is sadistic. I think I really like this guy." He watched as the dagger flashed down, narrowly missing Janice's throat, and Jared triggered the Zat in his hand, knocking the woman unconscious. "Nice," Xander complimented Jared as he walked up. "What now?" "Now I call the local FBI office and have them come and pick her up and her cultist. Unfortunately, I don't think any of them will see the inside of a prison, but I can be fairly certain they'll all be committed to a top security asylum for a long, long time." "Cool." Xander shook his head as Jared moved to hand the Zat back to him. "Tell you what, why don't you and I stick together for a while? Unless you have something else to do." "Sure," Jared smiled. "I'm very interested in the new world you've shown me. Where are we going?" Xander cradled his mask in the crook of his arm and grinned. "I have someone I need to say hi to in Terrace Point. Then I think I know some people you would like to meet in San Francisco." "Who?" Jared asked curiously. "Remember when you told me you were looking for your mother?" "Yes." "Do you have anything that has a connection to her?" Jared pulled out an old, beaten photograph and looked at it sadly. "Only this?" Xander glanced down at it and grinned. "Should be perfect.
I'm going to introduce you to a wicked trio of Wiccans who can cast a really cool locator spell. FBI offices, downtown. Excuse me, but have you seen this man? The agent looked at the photo for a second before answering. Sure, that's Agent Ford. He just took down those cult murderers. Flippin' Looney Tunes bunch thought they were sacrificing the people to some demon in exchange for financial success. Really? Parker didn't care. Do you know where I can find Agent Ford? The agent shrugged.
Sure.
He and his assistant just cleaned out their office. They're probably in the parking lot. Don't know how you missed them coming in. Parker swore under her breath and spun around, heading for the exit. The agent watched her go, grimacing. Christ, that guy Ford sure knows how to pick 'em. That assistant of his was scary enough the first day they showed up, but that lady's something else. Miss Parker swept into the parking lot, three sweepers on her heels, and scanned the area for Jared. There he is! She and the sweepers moved fast, maneuvering to corner Jared as he slammed the trunk of his Mustang and rushed around to the driver's seat. She drew her pistol but kept it low under her jacket as she saw Jared sitting in the driver's seat of his car, his hands already in the air. Hold it right there, Jared, she said as she leveled the pistol at him across the passenger seat. I'm not going anywhere, Miss Parker. Not yet, anyway. Oh, you're going somewhere, all right. You're going home to the center. I don't think so. You see, Jared paused for effect. I think my new friend would object to that. What new friend? Parker snarled and turned around. Behind her, she saw the three sweepers laying on the ground, unconscious. Hovering over them was a gleaming metal staff that seemed to be suspended in a blurry cushion of air. She watched, her jaw dropping as this blur shimmered and coalesced into an armored figure. What the hell are you? I would be the friend you was talking about. The figure's voice was distorted, sounding hollow under the armored helmet. Put down the gun. Are you and that stick gonna make me? She snarled, leveling the pistol at the form. No, it simply replied, a device on his shoulder abruptly coming to life and aiming at her directly. But this will.
I do what he says, Miss Parker.
Jared smiled, leaning over her shoulder and taking the pistol from her limp hands.
That's quite a lethal weapon.
Xander grinned at the look on her face and casually depressurized the helmet and slipped it into the crook of his arm.
I have to hand it to you, Jared. You called it perfectly. How did you know she'd be here?
Jared smiled. I've gotten to know her quite well over the years. She rarely does anything to surprise me. Parker snarled, watching as the smirking armored form got into the Mustang. I'll show you surprise yet, Jared.
Ta-ta, Jared called as he pulled out of the parking lot, tossing the pistol back over his shoulder as he did.
Parker winced as the nickel-plated automatic clattered along the pavement.
Man, you have to tell me who these people were, Xander laughed as he sped down the highway.
The lady was Miss Parker. She's a hunter for the corporation that kidnapped me as a child and raised me. They want me back.
Xander cooked an eyebrow at him. Why? I'm what they call a pretender. I can be anything I want to be. Read a book on surgery in the morning, perform the operation in the afternoon.
Xander was silent for a moment.
Damn. I take it you're not an FBI agent then.
Jared grinned, reached into his pocket and handed Xander a dozen IDs. Xander looked through them.
Forest ranger, doctor, fireman, SWAT officer, army ranger.
Geez, man, Xander whistled. I thought my life was screwy.
Being hunted by the center does tend to put a crimp in any long-term plans I might make.
Xander grinned. Ha! I'll see you a mysterious corporation and raise you a clandestine unit within the Air Force. Jared looked over at him.
Oh, this should be good. This has been Journeyverse Journeys, Part 17.
This has been Journeyverse Journeys, Part 17. Links below.